This tape illustrates uses of the Pixar image computer for scientific visualization of volumetric data sets. Many different tools available on the Pixar image computer were used to generate these images. Here, rendering and film loop tools are used to view clouds forming above the Earth's surface. In the first two sequences, weather data is rendered in three dimensions and is superimposed on a bas-relief rendering of the New England coast. This sequence shows the formation of Hurricane Diana. Note that the clouds cast shadows on the terrain below. In this sequence, three-dimensional clouds are shown above a Landsat thematic mapper image of the San Francisco Bay Area. This acoustically forced jet of gas is shown exiting from a nozzle. Blue is mapped to high densities of tracked particles, red to low densities. This cube of data is formed by stacking slices. The image of each slice was captured by a CCD array recording photons from laser-excited particles released into the gas jet. Cube tool is used to real-time roam the data, examining the interior structure of the jet. This illustrates classic image processing. Here, cross-section, histogram, and fast Fourier transform algorithms are being applied to a digitized photograph. In this case, a jet of gas. The jet is then rendered in three dimensions and individual frames of a flyby are generated. The film loop tool is used to view the flyby in real time. Any desired path can be flown through the data. This image was generated by sweeping a laser through serial sections of a puff of smoke. Cube tool is used to examine the interior structure of the smoke cloud. The structure can also be rendered in three dimensions and viewed as it rotates. To study fluid flow in turbulent boundary layers, dye is injected into water and excited by a laser for imaging. Cube tool is used to study the reconstructed volume. Again, the structure is rendered in three dimensions and viewed as it rotates. Here, cube tool is used to examine the total energy field surrounding a long, thin object moving through the atmosphere at Mach 1.9. The data is the result of a computer simulation. Red represents areas of high energy, and blue shows areas of low energy. This is a three-dimensional rendering of a very simple part found in many mechanical systems. The colors show different levels of stress for complex loading conditions calculated with Patran P-Stress, a stress analysis program. This image of the temporal bones of a human skull is the result of CT scanner images stacked into a volume and realistically shaded. A similar technique allows a cube tool examination of a human pelvis. In this case, magnetic resonance data has been used. This image is another CT scan reconstruction, in this case of a human chest and shoulders. Here, gradients are used to extract information at each voxel so that traditional computer graphic shading can be implemented. This sequence shows the first complete volume reconstruction of an animal. This image of a sea otter uses 374 CT scans stacked to form a three-dimensional volume of data. In the sciences, engineering, and medicine, we are looking for better ways to analyze and interpret both computer-generated information and natural phenomena. The data sets represented in the demonstration you have just seen could not have been rendered with traditional surface or line graphics. Pixar believes that volume visualization represents a major new tool for science and engineering.
The Connection Machine System is a data parallel computer. It utilizes 64,000 processors, which are configured to match the data structures of specific applications. Applications areas include image processing, document retrieval, seismic processing, circuit optimization, circuit simulation, and fluid dynamics. The Connection Machine System is ideal for image processing. The analysis of aerial images is one such application. Here, two cameras are pointed down at a model terrain. Because the cameras are at different positions, each sees the scene from a slightly different angle. Elements of the scene that are above ground level jump noticeably between the two views. Elements that are low to the ground appear in the same position in each image. Connection Machine stereo matching algorithms use this parallax phenomenon to compute the contours of the scene. Left and right images are brought into the system. Each image has 64K pixels. Each pixel is assigned to a separate processor. In a single computer operation, all the distortion in the images is removed. Next, the information in the images is compressed by keeping only the edges, the places in the image which go sharply from light to dark or dark to light. In the key step, the compressed images are shifted over each other. During this shift, areas where the terrain is high will align first. The lowest level areas will align last because they jump the least from left view to right view. The height of every edge section of the overall scene is computed from the alignment information gathered in the previous step. Here, the highest edges are shown in the lightest tones. The lowest areas are dark. Next, the height information is filled in for all the areas between the edges. And a contour map is computed. Processing requires 500 million computer operations and runs in half a second. Scientists are using the Connection Machine System to pioneer new approaches to fluid dynamic simulation. Previous methods have been based on partial differential equations. The Connection Machine approach models packets of particles directly. Operation of the system is straightforward. The flow of fluid can be started and stopped interactively. The density of the fluid can be adjusted up or down, as can the velocity. Several different flow parameters may be observed. Setup is straightforward. The user simply places an object into the fluid field and starts the simulation. At the beginning of the run, we see two vortices form behind the plate. In the color version of the output, the initial shock wave is clearly visible. The unsettled area behind the flat plate stretches out until it finally becomes unstable and breaks away. As the simulation proceeds, the whole complex behavior of fluids emerges. Vortices shed alternately from the top and bottom edges of the plate. Production of this 30-second sequence required 15 minutes of Connection Machine time. The results obtained by simulation match the behavior observed in real-world fluids. It is also easy to create new objects. Once created, objects may be placed in the fluid field and meaningful results obtained in a minute or so. The connection machine system updates 750 million sites per second. These six applications are suggestive of the many types of problems that connection machine systems solve. Applications cover the spectrum from words to pictures to numbers, and from commercial database to scientific problem solving. They also illustrate the ease with which the connection machine system is programmed. Each of these applications required less than a person year to implement.
How do you do? I'm Dr. Ernest Kent of the Sensory Interactive Robotics Group of the National Bureau of Standards. The demonstration that you're seeing on this tape is being taken live in real time through the new pipelined image processing engine, known as PIPE, at the Bureau. Now here we are looking at the first temporal derivative of the intensity of the image at a point. That is, we're weighting the past as minus one, we're weighting the future as one, we're summing them into the present and displaying the present. We can look at higher temporal derivatives as well. So what happens here is that only things that move show temporal changes in grayscale intensity, and as a result, only things that move appear in the image. And in fact, the degree of motion is reflected in the intensity of the image. If I stop moving altogether now, except for a Cheshire Cat grin, I disappear. But it's possible using PIPE's spatial and temporal operators simultaneously to build true feature detectors for temporal features. Now these are the kinds of things that people have talked about for years in the eye of the frog and so on, and we're now going to demonstrate one that we have built to run in PIPE in real time. Now what you're seeing here is a spatiotemporal feature detector. You'll notice that the lines in my image are all black or all white depending on the direction and magnitude of my horizontal motion. We're detecting here only things which are edges and which are moving horizontally only, and we're detecting the intensity proportional to the speed of that motion. If I take our line, you see that it's black going one way, it's white going the other direction. If we stand still, it disappears. If I turn it horizontally, it's not detected again except at the end points, and there only when it moves. If I move it now vertically, you see nothing. And here I've taken a sheet of paper and I've just drawn some black spots on it, and you can see that these black spots are disconnected. They might be the sort of thing that you would detect from a very noisy image if you were looking at a line such as the edge of a road, for example, in which the contrast was broken up by grass or obstructions of various sorts. And here you see the result. PIPE is hypothesizing a line connecting those dots. It has eliminated most of the other dots in the picture except for the edge of the paper up there. The little squiggles that you see on the side are hypotheses that are possible but are not correct. And the major hypothesis, as you see, is a correct connection of these broken line segments. And this can all occur in real time so that we can do real time pyramid operations. To our knowledge, PIPE is the only full scale real time pyramid machine in operation today.
This is the current prototype of the Pixel Planes graphics system at the Microelectronic Systems Laboratory of UNC Chapel Hill's Department of Computer Science. The system rapidly generates realistic, smooth-shaded images of three-dimensional objects and scenes. The machine's simplest software executes a Z-buffer visible surface algorithm from a scene description stored in a conventional display list. The only unusual aspect here is that the description of each polygon is broadcast into the frame buffer, and all the pixel-level processing is done by the custom, so-called smart frame buffer. That is, there is no rendering engine outside the frame buffer that converts a polygon into pixels and then stores each pixel in a conventional frame buffer memory. The display list, its traversal, the geometric transformations, and the conversion to pixel planes commands are all handled by a pipeline of three commercially available array processors made by Mercury Systems. They are shown here on the top rack. The pixel planes commands are sent to 2048 custom memory chips residing on 32 frame buffer memory boards. Each board contains 64 custom chips. Each chip contains memory and processing for 128 pixels. The heart of the system is this cluster of custom frame buffer memory chips, which perform calculations in parallel at every pixel with very little dedicated circuitry. Each chip contains, in addition to the usual pixel memories, a 1-bit arithmetic logic unit for each pixel and a binary tree of 1-bit adders that can rapidly evaluate linear expressions in the screen's X and Y coordinates for every pixel in the chip simultaneously. Fortunately, many pixel calculations turn out to be of this form, that is, linear in the screen space. Calculations of this form are very efficient in the system, since for them, only the linear coefficients A, B, and C, and their operation codes, need to be broadcast to memory chips. Each of these chips has a multiplier tree to calculate the expression AX plus BY plus C, and so only simple bit operations need to be done at the individual pixel level. A convex polygon can be rendered by broadcasting to the frame buffer the linear coefficients for each edge and having it turn off all pixels that are outside of that edge. All the pixels are on at the start of the polygon, and with each edge, more and more pixels get turned off until at the end, only those pixels inside the polygon are still on. Hidden surface calculations using the classic Z buffer algorithm are also done simultaneously for all pixels in a polygon using a single ABC linear coefficient set. These are the coefficients of the plane on which this polygon lies. Each pixel compares its new value that it receives from the multiplier tree with the old Z value that it's storing in the Z buffer. Shadows can also be calculated efficiently with linear expressions. Note that the shadows of one object can drape naturally onto and around other objects. They are not simple polygons painted only on the ground. The shadows are now being turned on and off for emphasis. A scene with shadows is calculated in about twice the time of the same scene without shadows. Here we show an extreme close-up of the screen to demonstrate our first anti-aliasing method. The staircasing artifacts are minimized by successive refinement oversampling whenever the system has spare time. That occurs whenever the user stops moving the object. At these times, the system continues to calculate additional samples within each pixel and filtering appropriately. Whenever the user is moving the object, however, the system abandons anti-aliasing in the interest of speed. Circles are displayed essentially as polygons with one edge, because the nonlinear terms x squared plus y squared are constant and are pre-stored in each pixel. This technique, suggested by Fred Brooks, allows the system to rapidly display molecular models like these. Here are two molecules with over 1,000 atoms. Notice that they can be independently controlled and can pass through each other without difficulty. In fact, we would sometimes like to prevent objects like these two from passing through each other, and so have started to work on interference checking, so-called bump checking, to further help the user understand how two molecules like this large protein and the small drug can fit together. Notice that the light source can also be moved interactively, as seen here, moving from left to right. Here is an image processing application using Steve Pizer's adaptive histogram equalization technique being applied to a CT scan cross-section of a human patient's chest. The number of intensity levels in the data is much greater than the number that can be discerned on any video display. So normally, it's very difficult to see detail in both the dense bony areas and also detail in the soft tissue. This technique you see being executed in a few seconds on pixel planes takes about 1.5 hours on a VAX 11780. We toggle here between the original and the final image to allow you to compare the apparent detail in both the bony areas, like the spine near the bottom of the image, and the lungs that take up most of the middle. This is reconstructed anatomy from dozens of cross-sectional CT scans of a patient at North Carolina Memorial Hospital. We see the skin of the torso with some bones inside. Radiation therapists are working with these reconstructions in hopes of improving the effectiveness of their therapy plans. We remove the skin to reveal the pelvic bones and some organs.
This demonstration will show you a new engineering toolset, a toolset that is changing the way engineers work. For the first time, you can work with a computing tool that deals with the world of the mechanical engineer, the three-dimensional world of real objects in real time. Unlike MCAE systems you may have used, Super Workstations let you interact with your design immediately as it evolves. That exceptional graphic capability sets Silicon Graphics Super Workstations apart from all your other computing choices. What is a Super Workstation? First, computing power to manipulate complex engineering models quickly, with industry standard operating systems, so your software choices stay open, and with the networking and connectivity you need to integrate the systems into your environment. Finally, Super Workstations bring you the graphics power for 4D computing, three dimensions moving in real time. That interactive power has a substantial payback. IBM studies of the effect of decreased system response time in graphics applications show that faster system response time can increase user transactions with the computer dramatically, leading to project time to completion savings of 30%, 40%, 50% and more over conventional computers. That is the Super Workstation advantage. More important, only Silicon Graphics makes that high-performance graphics power easy for software vendors to use. That's why there is so much more software available to take advantage of real-time power on Super Workstations. A wide variety of outstanding packages for every stage of MCAE from today's leading software vendors. Running on Super Workstations, these tools give you power to explore more design ideas in the same amount of time, or to analyze and model more thoroughly, or to design faster and get to market sooner. Advantages at every stage of the design cycle. At the conceptual design stage, you can visualize objects in realistic, three-dimensional detail before even creating a physical prototype. At the modeling and analysis stage, you can prototype and test in software extensively. At the manufacturing stage, you can simulate NC machine tool cutter paths, factory floor operations, or complete work cells. At the concept design level, RepliCore provides an outstanding tool set for the creation of complex three-dimensional geometry. RepliCore also features interfaces to import geometry from different systems and to export geometry to those systems. This allows the visualized object, for example, to be sent to manufacturing packages for toolpath programming or to simulation packages for finite element modeling. RepliCore also features fluid flow calculations for wind tunnel simulations of surface geometry. Here you see tracer particle flow across an airframe. Results are displayed dynamically. The blue and green lines represent equipotential pressure areas, while the moving dots represent the path of tracer particles. Color maps allow surfaces to be shaded for fastest interpretation, and all surfaces can be rotated dynamically or presented in multiple formats simultaneously.
Under the direction of Professor Stephen Benton, the recently formed Spatial Imaging Group's aim is to develop and demonstrate the powerful potential of three-dimensional imaging as an efficient means for communications. One of their recent achievements is the invention of a new type of large-scale, multicolored computer graphic hologram.
Now, ordinarily, the hologram just looks like a piece of glass or plain film, but when it's angled properly to the light, it diffracts it and sends an image straight ahead to your eye. And right here, that's a two-dimensional image. But if you move, or the hologram moves, then you see a sequence of right to left views that gives you the impression of three-dimensionality. And because the transitions between those views is smooth enough, it actually looks like a hologram of a solid object.
Research is now underway to make the holograms more quickly in full color and also much larger. The group is also working on such technical problems as developing specialized computer graphics, assembling computer automated hologram printers, and inventing new optical systems for high quality production and display of large scale 3D images. Holographically stored images will be documented to allow convenient visualization of intricate shapes, forms, and spatial relationships in the fields of medicine, art, education, as well as architecture and in engineering design. In addition to their purely technical work, the group is deeply concerned with advances in the aesthetics of three-dimensional image creation and perception. A special emphasis will be placed on research in synthetic holograms, which are not made from real objects, but rather they are synthesized from hundreds of perspective views of an object rendered from a computer database, like those used for structural engineering. The images to be prepared for holographic hard copy can be quickly edited and previewed with interactive devices such as the Trillium Flight Simulator, and then rendered in full realistic detail using computer ray tracing techniques. Ray tracing can also predistort the images to match the anamorphic projection optics designed into the new holographic exposure method. The design of those optical systems is also expedited with specialized interactive computer programs. The holography laboratory has been outfitted with state-of-the-art equipment, such as large vibration isolation tables, powerful argon and helium neon lasers, and programmable positioning equipment, which has been specially designed for holographic exposures.
This is a prototype of a new holographic format, which we're calling the alcove hologram. In it, the holographic film is stretched around a concave cylinder to project the image out in front, where you can almost touch it. And the cylindrical shape makes it visible over a wide viewing zone, almost 180 degrees. We expect to make some major changes in the overall look of holograms, not just in terms of the content, whether it's medical or engineering or computer graphic images, but in terms of the size, in terms of the color, and even in terms of the format of holograms. We expect holography to move ahead very quickly over the next several years.
The purpose of this system is to take an aerial image, for example, and assist the user in a variety of cartographic tasks. As we see in these computer-generated motion sequences, particular attention is being paid to the development of tools that provide the viewer with cartographically useful depictions of the information in the database. The basic information used by the system includes digitized images, camera models, solar illumination information, and digital terrain elevation data. Here we show the way a camera viewing the terrain would appear to an outside observer. The four lines show the limits of the camera's field of view. If we wish, we can invoke a menu that allows us to examine and alter the numerical parameters of this camera model. Now suppose we add a second stereographic viewpoint of the scene. If we move a three-dimensional point around in the world, we can use the camera model information to project the point so that it appears overlaid on each image exactly as the cameras would see it. Here, we draw lines from the point's position in the world to the film planes to illustrate how this is done. As the point moves in the world, its projection into each of the camera views changes accordingly. Among the ways we can move the point in the world are the following. Move the point horizontally. Move the point's altitude alone. Or fix the point's location in the image being examined and move along the camera ray, thus causing it to move along the epipolar lines in the other image. The system is designed to support not only stereographic image pairs, but also multiple images covering the same geographic area. One of the most useful features of our computer-based approach is, in fact, the ability to register the world position of a single feature accurately in many different images simultaneously. Here, we consider yet another image of the scene taken from a camera located near the ground, as shown schematically in the upper left display pane. All the camera transformations are used in tandem to compute the exact position of the object seen against the background of each image. As a result, three-dimensional registration of the object position can be checked not only in stereographic pairs of images, but also in sets of images taken from extremely different viewpoints. We display an image, create an object, and adjust some of the degrees of freedom until they coincide with our perception of the real feature we are trying to model. Here, after delineating the top of the building, we use an existing terrain elevation model to place its base on the ground and adjust the height to match the image information. When we have constructed an object and adjusted it to match a feature's appearance, we often find that identical structures occur elsewhere in the scene. In such cases, the system allows us to duplicate or clone the object as many times as we wish, thereby reducing the time it takes to construct models for all the features that need to be compiled in that database. When we have a set of features in a scene compiled into the database, we may replace the wireframe depictions of the objects used for interactive purposes by realistic shaded renderings, such as those shown here. No restriction is imposed by the system on the viewpoint from which the features can be seen. If we wish to see how the objects look from a fictitious camera that does not correspond to any of the available images, we simply move the camera position until we have the desired viewpoint. Camera parameters such as focal length and principal point may also be altered interactively. Once we have a new viewpoint that meets our needs, we may create a synthetic image corresponding to that viewpoint. This is accomplished by simulating the process of projecting the original image onto a plaster model of the terrain elevation data. A synthetic image is constructed by computing the way this projection would look from some arbitrary place. This is the technique that was used to construct each of the frames of the computer-generated movie shown at the beginning. In situations where one is dependent upon shadow information to determine the parameters of the feature models, there is one particularly useful artificial viewpoint that we may construct: the view of the scene taken from a hypothetical camera located at the sun position, shown here in the lower right-hand window. As we see here, the path of a ray of sunlight from a point in space to its intersection with the terrain elevation model tells us where the corner's shadow will fall for any chosen height. Every illuminated point in the sun view coincides with the path of a distinct ray of sunlight. Thus, the corners of a building model, for example, must line up with their shadows in the synthetic image. Provided the terrain model is sufficiently accurate, the shadow positions can then be used directly to determine an object's physical height. By repeatedly invoking the facility for the construction of simulated viewpoints, we may make a series of images of the scene as it would appear to a moving observer. To accomplish this, one chooses a three-dimensional flight path along which simulated scene views are to be created. Such simulated views can provide the user with a superior perception of the terrain and the features in the database. Based on our experience with this experimental system, we can now imagine powerful new computer environments for cartographic feature compilation, as well as remarkable new ways of viewing and understanding a scene's information content.
First of all, I have a gear on the screen. This has been done using wireframe modeling, which is historically the way a lot of mechanical engineering design has been done, and is the way a lot of things are done even today. A lot of systems are host-based right now, and this system, however, is a workstation configuration, and there's very tight coupling between the graphics engine and the host, in this case, the Model 320. Wireframe's been used a lot historically because it is very interactive. It's fairly simple. Solids can be first introduced by just going in and flat filling all of those polygons. In this case, we've just flat filled the ring in one color and the shaft in another. A more realistic image would be to add a light source. Facet shading means that the intensity and color of the pixels is based on the source of the light, but there's only one calculation done for each polygon, so the polygon is of equal intensity and color across that polygon, and it gives it a faceted appearance. It is fairly realistic looking in terms of getting a feel for it being three-dimensional, but again has some ambiguity in terms of, is this shaft faceted or is it a smooth shaft? By going in and introducing what's called Garot shading, which is a smooth shading technique, it's a linear interpolation where you calculate the intensity and color values at the vertices of the polygon and then linearly interpolate across those, the polygon, you can create a smooth shaded effect. Part of the reason why we can keep up our real-time speed in this case using Garot shading is we've invested in an NMOS 3 chip, which allows us to do very fast calculations of the Bresingham algorithm, both for X and Y in the traditional sense, but also for R, G, and B for color information, and Z for use in hidden surface calculations. Another capability is the ability to not only model a light source with diffuse reflections. In this case, the surface is considered diffuse, which means it doesn't reflect a specular component. If I add specular highlighting to the image, and I'll kind of turn that on and off a couple of times so you can see it, you can get a feel for a shininess to the object or a metallic appearance. In this case, we still have good interactivity with the object. The designer can look at it from a lot of different angles. He can move the light source around on the object as well. You can move the light source up or down below. There's another capability for modeling that's becoming very desirable as a future capability in the industry, and that's the ability to represent geometries using B-splines. B-spline is just a higher level mathematical form which can describe say a curve by describing control points along the curve and the math to describe how the curve flows in relation to those control points, and then extending that, of course, in another direction to create surfaces. So by varying just these nine control points, I can really create just a infinite variation in the theme here in terms of what the surface looks like. And you can imagine this could be a whole new way for a designer to interact with the geometry in terms of manipulating control points and getting the surface to look the way he wants. The same capabilities in terms of moving the object around or moving the light on the object are still available. I can move the light source around on the object, or I can choose to rotate the object around and take a look at it from different viewing angles. I'll bring up one more image, which is a more complete piece of geometry that's been created using B-splines. This particular data set is courtesy of SDRC, which is one of the third-party packs that's supported on the 320 SRX. And in this case, this image is of a manifold. This manifold normally would take about 15,000 polygons to describe, but in this case, by describing it with B-splines, we can reduce the amount of data required to store in the database by about a 78-to-1 factor. So not only are B-splines good for maintaining a precise representation of the object, but they're also very concise as well, and that's an added bonus for the central database. Well, you'll notice that this object is not complete. The end caps of the manifold are missing. This is brings me to a unique capability in the industry right now for a graphics device to be able to accept directly from an application B-spline curves and surfaces and apply trimming curves to those to create a an end plate such as this. So for tutorial purposes, we've put up an end cap. We can trim that using B-spline operations. And then finally, place this end cap on the manifold to complete the geometry.
From the beginning of interactive computer graphics at MIT in the early 1960s until the first workstations were developed in the early 1980s, the typical graphics system was configured around some kind of display terminal connected to a host computer. As microprocessors and special purpose integrated circuits became available and the cost of memory decreased, the trend in the industry was to give the display more local intelligence, more local storage, more color, and faster drawing speed. With the advent of the 32-bit 68000 family of microprocessors from Motorola in the 1980s, general-purpose programmable computing power was also moved over to the display, and the workstation concept was born. In the ensuing years, workstations have developed rapidly, pushing display terminals out of the mainstream and into narrow market niches where they can still offer some performance advantage. Turner Whitted, a leading graphics software developer, explains why.
I don't want a skinny cord between what I'm doing and that terminal. There are, for one thing, a terminal will not support the richness of application that's coming along now. The application and the display have to be so intimate that you can't afford to do it in a terminal. So the notion of having a terminal at the end of a what we call a skinny cord, I don't care how wide it is, it's still skinny if it's not memory maps, is not something that's going to survive, and it hasn't survived.
From their conception, workstations have promised greater productivity for engineering and scientific users, and this in turn promised a rapidly growing, potentially huge market that attracted a multitude of vendors. Carl Mackover, noted industry consultant, gave this analysis of workstation market evolution in August 1986.
Fortunately, I think we're breaking out of the JAWS concept. You know, for JAWS, just another workstation, for about 4 years we had a series of rather innocuous introductions of workstations where it was virtually impossible to tell the difference from one to another. And you would ask the vendor or people from the company as to what the difference is, and the answers always were, well, we've created a better balance between computation and displays. And if you look carefully at it, it was very difficult to find that balance. I think what's happened is that the market is really breaking into two parts. I think it's breaking into what I would describe as standard platforms. The Apollos, the Suns, the Microvacs, and the RTs represent almost a commodity-like product at this point. And for the baseline applications in which performance is less critical than the stability of the vendor and price, decisions are probably going to be made among those four vendors. Others certainly, but among those four. On the other hand, we will continue to require very high performance applications that these standard platforms are not prepared to equip.
At the same time, the distinction is disappearing between low-end workstations that keep getting cheaper and high-end personal computers that keep getting more powerful.
Two things define a workstation. One is reasonable performance. Second is the display, meaning a bitmap display with multiple windows, etc. Thirdly, networking. Those are the primary considerations. Okay, on IBM PC class machines, I can buy networking from third parties. I can buy bitmap displays from third parties. I can make a workstation from pieces, and I can run any application I want in that workstation. Okay. From the traditional workstation manufacturers, I can buy the whole thing already integrated. Now, interestingly enough, the prices of the two things I've just described are about the same. So we can safely say that the workstation and the PC have collided in a sort of without much of a splash.
Deck showed a new low-cost monochrome workstation called the VacStation 2 RC, selling for about $15,000, making it price competitive with the monochrome Apollo DN3000 and the Sun 3110. The VacStation 2 RC comes with a 19-inch monitor, 3 megabytes of RAM, a 75-megabyte disk, a 95-megabyte streaming tape, mouse, keyboard, Ethernet, and VMS Ultrix software. DEC also showed new configurations of its VacStation 2 GPX that refined its color offerings to more precisely fit specific application requirements. The 8-plane model shown here sells for about $40,000 with 5 megabytes of RAM and similar peripherals. It features the X-Window user interface developed by MIT, which allows networking between windows, even to the point of different applications running under different operating systems within separate windows on the same screen. Apollo Computer helped pioneer scientific workstations and remains one of the world's leading vendors. In 1986, we saw Apollo's first model, the DN100, next to its current bestseller, the DN3000. The price-performance contrast after only 5 years was dramatic. When it was first introduced in 1981, the monochrome DN100 sold for about $35,000 and was rated at 0.3 MIPS. In 1986, the monochrome DN3000 sold for under $15,000 and was rated at 1.2 MIPS, four times the performance for less than half the price. Silicon Graphics introduced the Iris 4D60 Super Workstation in 1987, significantly raising the performance of the top of its product line while maintaining software and database compatibility with its older Iris 3030 and 3100 series of Unix workstations. The rapid growth of Silicon Graphics since its founding in 1981 is due in part to its pioneering use of custom VLSI for graphics processing. But energetic marketing and attention to the customer have also played an important role. The Iris 4D60 uses the new R2000 32-bit RISC processor from MIPS Computer as a CPU. The R2000, running at 8 megahertz, performs integer processing at a sustained rate of 5 million instructions per second, seven times the Drystone performance of a VAX 11780, and more than three times faster than the older Iris 3030. Floating point performance of the 4D is 25% faster than the 3030. It will increase another 200% when the new R2010 floating point processor from MIPS Computer becomes available. Increased compute power can be seen in this real-time demonstration. The system is recalculating this scene at the rate of about 5 frames per second, taking advantage of the system's optional 24-bit Z buffer to do fast hidden surface removal. The Iris 4D still uses the company's patented Geometry Engine and Geometry Accelerator VLSI chips running at 10 megahertz.
The workstation industry as we know it is a byproduct of the 68000 family. Okay. The workstation industry now has overwhelmed the 68000 family. The workstation industry cannot afford to wait for the 68030, if there is such a thing. So as you see, they're looking desperately for other processors, either designing their own or going to other manufacturers to bring them in, because the workstation industry itself, which is a product of that chip, has overwhelmed it and in a sense accelerated past it and is now going off in all possible directions. Well, it's going into high end. People are finding either faster chips or building their own to get very, very high performance. This notion of a crayette under your desk is going to catch on, especially for scientific applications, and it's going down. The notion of having a workstation for business applications should catch on. Software is a stumbling block there. There's no hardware limitation because there are introductions now of smaller versions of workstations which have all the workstation functionality, all the workstation performance, but they're smaller physically and they have lower cost. They're creeping down on the PCs. The PCs are creeping up in performance. They're going to meet somewhere, and I think we're all going to benefit from that.
Turner Whitted's 1986 predictions are all the more true in 1987. The 386 PC from Compaq, the new Personal System 2 machines from IBM, and others built around the 80386 from Intel will allow faster performance of more complex applications and even promise multitasking on PC hardware platforms.
Meanwhile, the upper limits of workstation performance are rising rapidly with the implementation of more parallelism, more custom graphics chips, and more reduced instruction set computers, so-called RISC processors. The general aim of RISC architecture is to obtain enhanced performance by simplifying the underlying hardware and handling only a small set of the most frequently used instructions. These RISC processors are the basis of new workstations with sustainable performance in the 5 MIPS range from Silicon Graphics, Intergraph, and IBM. Continuing development of RISC processors suggests increasingly powerful workstations in the future from these and other vendors. IBM has introduced a more powerful version of its RTPC workstation, which, compared with its predecessor, offers more than double the processing speed, up to 8 times the floating point performance, 4 times the RAM capacity, and 4 times faster disk-to-memory transfer rates. In this demonstration, identical benchmark programs are running on the older Model 25 RTPC on the left and the newer Model 125 RTPC on the right. Both systems are configured with 4 megabytes of memory, optional floating point processors, and 14-inch color displays. The upgraded IBM RTPC is based on a new 32-bit RISC-type CPU developed by IBM using 1-micron CMOS technology. This chip runs at 10 megahertz and delivers 4.5 MIPS. The system's standard floating point processor is a 20 megahertz Motorola 68881 chip, but there is also an optional floating point processor featuring LINPACK performance of 300 kiloflops. Single unit price of the 6150 RTPC Model 125 is $16,100.